Okay, then I can start with some remarks about Sakharov.
Ah, okay, so let's start. Let's give Arkady 2 more minutes. And the next talk is by Arkady Tseytlin, so he's going to talk about integrability and RG4 into dimensional sigma models. Please.
Thank you. Yeah, so since the conference is quarks combined with Sakharov Centennial Conference, I decided to just make a 1 minute comment on how I became aware of Sakharov and my meetings with him. It's like back 41 years ago, I just finished Moscow University, studies at Moscow University. I was given my first talk research seminar at Lebedev Institute. And it was like, I think end of January 1980. And I noticed that people were not really much interested in my talk. So the audience, they were always just talking to each other rather than listening to what I was saying, which partly was maybe my talk was not very interesting anyway. But later I learned that they were discussing Sakharov being exiled to Gorky, and that happened a few days ago before my visit. Indeed, at the end of 1979, the Soviet troops were deployed in Afghanistan, and Sakharov opposed that and gave some interviews to Western correspondents, and that led to his sort of exile to Gorky, and which was off limits for Western correspondents, where he lived in an apartment and he could continue his work, and he was formally associated with Lebedev Institute. KGB allowed visits of members of staff of Lebedev Institute to visit Sakharov occasionally, and just to keep, to pretend there is some scientific contact, that he's still working and he's in contact with people at Lebedev. So Misha Vasilyev mentioned that already in his talk at the beginning of the conference. So I also visited him together with Fratkin and Feinberg twice in 1985. And in one of these visits, he asked me to talk about what I was interested in, et cetera. And I was discussing string theory and relation to low energy effective actions, et cetera. So somehow this is not unrelated to what I'm going to talk about. So this is just to say a few words about Sakharov, and then I'm ready to continue with my talk. So I think I can continue then. Right, so the talk will be about a relation between integrability and RG flow in 2D sigma models. It's unrelated to string theory directly, but I will mention some connections. So it's based on our joint work with Ben Hoare and Nat Levin. And so I first discussed some earlier papers, and then later I get to most recent paper. And it's related to, this second part will be related to what Gleb was talking about in the previous talk. So let me start with just quick review. So we will be looking at two-dimensional sigma models, and in particular, integrable sigma models, which are of course of interest from various points of view, but also from the point of view of finding new solvable string theories. And there's no general classification of integrable sigma models, and in fact, hard to find them. There's no general method of constructing locks, or one could try to construct S matrix, but it's also, there's no general rules. But one could try some kind of heuristic approach, look for stability under RG flow. And this goes back to early work by Fatih Anofri and Zamolochikov, who first discussed, they considered a model which they expected to be integrable, and they looked at RG flow, one loop Ricci flow, to see what kind of deformation of two-dimensional sphere will be stable under RG flow. And that they conjectured should correspond to integrable S matrix, which they had a guess for. So one could ask what happens at higher loops. So that was just Ricci flow, one loop RG stability. And the question which we would like to address is what happens at higher loops. And what happens is that in general, you need to deform the metric. So you start with classical theory, which has lux, but RG flow demands that you deform the metric in certain particular way. So that means deformation of geometry. So to put it into the right framework, suppose we start with two-dimensional sigma model, and that theory can be thought of as infinite coupling theory. So you can write metric as some expansion in, say, near the origin, and it's parameterized by infinite number of couplings, which are values of curvature and derivatives at the origin. So we're really talking about RG flow in infinite dimensional space, and it can be organized in a way which looks covariant, where you take derivative of the metric over RG parameter, and up to diffeomorphism term, the beta function starts with Ricci tensor, then there is a square term and higher order terms. So I sometimes will use alpha prime or h bar as loop counting parameter, but sometimes I'll set it to one, so like here. The idea is to see what happens when what you need really to restrict the flow to finite subspace, finite subspace of couplings. So canonical example is just a sphere. It's a randomizable theory. Why? Because sphere global symmetry, if you want to RG flow to preserve it, then you have only option of randomizing the radius or the coupling in front of the action. But what if symmetry is hidden? If you don't see this symmetry manifestly in Lagrangian, like in integrable models, that the symmetry is implicit. And one could conjecture that in, when the symmetry is implicit, the flow still should remain on the same subspace of couplings, finite dimensional subspace of couplings as at one loop order or as defined by classical theory. But in general, that would imply that you need to deform geometry in a certain way. But number of running couplings will remain the same. And example that I already mentioned is what's called sausage model or deformed two-sphere. And it's actually the same as Young-Baxter deformation, or Eta deformation, of SO3 over SO2. And that's the metric. And this is the metric of a sphere, two-dimensional sphere. And this coupling, radius squared or inverse coupling squared, kappa is deformation parameter. So the model is integrable. And H and kappa, that's how they run at one loop. And in fact, H over kappa is RG invariant. And the question which we would like to address is what happens at, say, two loop order. Beyond one loop, what you could expect that hidden symmetry somehow constrain RG flow. And the interpretation of what happens is that to preserve integrability, we may need to add finite counter terms. And that will translate into some deformation of the metric. And indeed, direct-to-loop computation shows that you need to change the classical metric, this deformed two-sphere, by extra term. And you see this first term is multiplied by H, and the second term doesn't have H. So it's like one loop, finite one loop counter term, but it's needed to sort of satisfy two-loop RG equation. And here's a heuristic reason why you should be able to find such deformation, finite counter term, is that we expect there is a quantum integral S matrix underlying this integral model. And essentially that was kind of the logic of this original paper. And then S matrix will depend on RG invariant parameters, while the running scale will be kind of absorbed into dynamical mass. So this is the massive S matrix. So that suggests that RG flow should remain at high loops only with one non-trivial running coupling. So again, this is the logic here should be that there's some what identities which maintain this hidden symmetry, and that tells us what kind of finite counter terms we need to add to restore the invariant. And now let me give some couple of examples where somewhat similar situation happens when we have some deformation of the original classical geometry. So this first example is T-duality. You can consider usual sphere, so here in different coordinates, two-dimensional sphere, and suppose we do T-duality in Y. So this sine squared gets inversed. So this model has SO3 symmetry. This T-dual model doesn't have SO3 symmetry. And this SO3 symmetry was the one which constrained the flow in the first model that told us that only the radius is running or the H was running. Now in the second model, you may be puzzled what happens. You don't have global symmetry, but in fact, global symmetry is hidden. SO3 is still there, it's just not realized manifestly. It's nonlinear, kind of nonlinear realized. And indeed, one could add finite counter terms or deform T-duality transformation rule at two and higher local orders so that this model is also a solution. Plus, we can deform this model or add corrections to T-duality transformation so that the only remaining coupling which it will run is H. So that's the reason one can understand why that happens is going through the way how T-duality is implemented essentially by replacing coordinate Y by gauge field gauging and adding extra constraint, which is T-dual field, which imposes flatness of this A. And then in terms of this A, you get a term which M is being the coefficient of device squared in the original metric. And integrating A's, you get a shift of dilaton, which is very familiar, but you also get a finite counter term, which is logarithm of this coefficient of dy, the one which we dedualize. And this is essentially the origin of deformation. And this is leads to one loop counter term. And the moral is that T-duality commutes with RG flow, provided you add certain finite counter terms or deform the T-dual geometry in a certain way, but number of running couplings is still preserved. And the same story applies to non-abelian duality. So you can consider not non-abelian duality and use similar arguments. And the bottom line is that you, when you do these dualities, which are just two-dimensional scalar-scalar dualities, which you can implement through path integral, you shouldn't really be changing number of conserved currents, conserved charges, and that should constrain RG flow. Another example is an old example of complex Sangoddon model, which that's a Lagrangian of this model, which essentially is two-dimensional sigma model of kind of this gauge sigma model type or two-dimensional black hole analytic continued plus a potential, plus sine squared potential. So this theory is integrable, classically integral. There is this matrix factorizes, but if you ask what happens at one loop level, you discover this matrix no longer factorizes. You need that finite counter term. And that was observed a long time ago, but I think 81. And the origin of this counter term is actually the deformation which you need to add to this gauge sigma model part of this, to this kinetic term at higher order to preserve conformal invariance or preserve its consistency with underlying symmetries. So in gauge Berzomina model, the geometry, why geometry is deformed, you can understand just looking at stress tensor or the corresponding L0 operator, and looking at what is the geometry which you see when you're probing this CFT by point-like source or point-like string, point-like. So then the Hamiltonian translates into generalized Laplacian, which depends on the metric and dilaton, and you can read off what's the metric and dilaton from the structure of the stress tensor, essentially, of the Cossack construction. And what you learn is you get the metric and dilaton, which you get 1/k corrections. And 1/k here is the essentially expansion loops. So similar logic, similar deformation you can get from kind of effective field theory approach, where you start with gauge Berzomino action. And you can argue that you need to add a finite counter term like this when you go to quantum level. at the quantum level. So, and also the way to understand what why we get deformation of geometry when we integrate this A out, the gauge field of from the subgroup, we get extra counted term also from A squared term. And for a simple example of SL2U1, that translates into that kind of metric. So instead of usual two-dimensional black hole metric, like with tangent, you get tangent corrected by 1/k terms. And you can absorb the, you also have shift of level in front, but that can be absorbed into redefinition of radius. But essentially you get a series of 1/k corrections. And you may say, why we need them? A kind of pedestrian argument would be just look at what happens at, with conformal invariance of this metric beyond one loop. It's conformally invariant in one loop up to dilaton term, but beyond one loop, if you add higher order loop corrections, you will need to deform the metric to satisfy conformal invariance equation, to satisfy beta function being zero up to dilaton term. And that can be checked to two loop and higher loop orders. So essentially this metric is the answer to solution of conformal invariance and to in particular scheme, et cetera. But that's what happens in gauge with a minimal, but the paradigm is similar to what happens also in integrable models where we look at RG flow rather than fixed point of RG flow. So back to the Zeta model or sausage model, that was the original metric again. This metric for cup equals zero is just a sphere. It's actually flat for formal choice of kappa squared minus one, this deformation parameter minus one. And in this limit with particular redefinition of radius, you can actually, you discover that this metric also reduces to this black hole metric, two-dimensional black hole. So it kind of interpolates between the sphere and two-dimensional black hole if you properly take some limit. So, given this observation, one can try to guess what should be the exact deformation of this metric, which will solve RG flow to all orders. And that's what we did in a paper with Ben and Nat. Again, motivated by the exact gauge with the minimum metric, that's how it looks like. It's written, I just wrote that metric dividing by tangent. So we can get cotangent minus 2k minus 1. So similar generalization is possible for that sausage model. So essentially you just get 2/k term in the second term in the sausage model metric. And that's what will ensure that we have actually solution to the RG flow equations. So we check that directly at say a two loop order, again, just solving RG equations. You discover you need this counter term or deformation with this 1/h h of this coefficient entry. And that ensures that h and kappa still solve the RG equation. So the, again, the moral is that we have integral, classically integral model with two parameters, h and kappa, and provided it's properly deformed, it still solves RG equation. And the same expected for Young-Baxter deformation of sigma models in general. So similar story works for the other deformation, which is called lambda deformation. It's essentially gauge with the minimum model plus some particular extra term square, a squared term. P is a projection to subgroup. So it's this J over H theory. A belongs to H, P is projection to G over H, and B is a new parameter, which is related to lambda. That's why it's called lambda deformation. So why this model is of interest? For B equals zero, it's just gauge with the minimum model. And for a particular limit, when k goes to infinity, B goes to infinity, this is a model which appears in discussing non-abelian dual of Kossoff, usual Kossoff model, G over H. It's essentially an interpolating model where you introduce Lagrange multiplier V, which sets field strength of A to zero, and then you get Kossoff model. Well, here it's written for just usual usual group space. So this model is randomizable, this one, but what happens at two loop order? And the answer again is if you go through the steps of integrating A out to get this usual sigma model, you need a counter term. And that's an example for SO1, 2 over SO2. It's a two-dimensional model, different from this ITER model, which I discussed earlier. So here, you don't have even U1 isometry, you have two coordinates P and Q, and that's how the metric looks like. And K here is this other kappa, is related to B or lambda. And the one loop counter term you need, that's how it looks like in this case. And again, you solve RG equations and you discover that K and kappa run in that particular way. So this K is no longer a level, it's, well, there is RG invariant, which is combination of these parameters. So in non-abelian dual limit, you get that kind of model, which is non-abelian dual of usual, say sphere, or this coset. And again, it's two-loop renormalizable, provided we add this counter term, and we get essentially the same two-loop beta function as for the usual hyperboloid, for which we start for which this is non-abelian dual. And I'm not discussing this in much detail because that's not my main subject. So bottom line is that that example illustrates that non-abelian dual is consistent with two-loop RG flow, provided we had finite counter terms. And the same will be for Poisson Lie duality, in fact. And it's not unrelated to the fact that number model and ITER model are Poisson dual to each other. So Poisson Lie duality should also be consistent with RG flow. Now, another interesting observation is that number model formulated on a bigger space, namely on a space of G times G times G, it's actually RG invariant without any deformation. So this RG flow becomes kind of linearized on a bigger space. So this bigger space is just a space of where you introduce independent fields, H and H bar for A and plus and A minus, which are gauge fields in this regional Lagrangian. And then you have three fields, G, H and H bar. And if you consider RG flow on that bigger space, you don't need deformation. So you have only lambda running. And I think I skipped this story. So that's essentially the message. And you get the same beta function for group space or coset space. That's how lambda runs. Here we don't need to do anything with the model itself. It's just the model boils down to two Vesemina-Witten models coupled in certain way. And here there's enough global symmetry just to preserve renormalizability of this model so that only lambda runs. So now I switch to to this new work with recent work with Nat Levin. It's about, which is closely related to the previous talk by Glenn. So that'll be about RG flow in integrable GOG models. He discussed, we'll be concentrating on just product of two groups and then coset. And we also discussed slight generalization of this T11 model, which he discussed. So again, this is sigma model now with B field. we will be using special RG scheme for the models like this, which treat metric and B field on equal footing. It's in a way a scheme which is adapted to discussing Vesemina models and similar models related to Vesemina-Witten similar integral models. In this particular scheme, the beta function, that's how it looks like. It's essentially written in terms of generalized curvature, but not completely. There is a term which doesn't depend on, depends explicitly on the field strength of B. So that's important formula, which we just use for the sigma model like this to check what happens with RG flow. So G over G, G times G, G models, they essentially have a structure, they generalize usual principal chiral model with Vesemina term. So there are two parameters, H, the coefficient in front of usual principal chiral model term group space, and K is a level of Vesemina. So they are in general independent. If they are related, that's Vesemina-Witten model conformal, but in general you have a flow of H, K is not randomized. So how we can generalize, this model is integrable of course, and how we generalize it to more general, to other integral models. So one option is consider integral deformations that what we discussed earlier. And another option is to couple several PCM K models. And that's what Kleb discussed. That's a model by Delduc, Lacroix, Magro, Veseda. So you take a product of groups, you take PCMK models, principal chiral models with as many terms for all these groups, and you couple them through constant matrix, which multiplies the product of two currents here. So levels are all independent, and rho ij is just a constant matrix. So then you ask what happens under RG flow. So here there is enough global symmetry. So the only thing which can run is ki will not run, rho ij can run. And on top of that, you can ask when this model is integral. So that imposes constraints on this rho ij. And these constraints come from this Gaudin construction, and they are certain polynomial equations. So in g times g case, this rho ij, which need not be symmetric, it has symmetric and symmetric part. This integrability condition in this case is just one polynomial. That's how it looks like. So S, T, U, and B are parameters, are couplings, which enter this rho ij. Just S, T, U, and B are four parameters. And this polynomial depends on certain levels K1 and K2. So that's how it looks like. And the question is then, what happens under RG flow? Is that randomization group, integrability condition that F should be zero is preserved by flow of STU B. And one can study this at one loop level, at one loop level that was done in earlier paper. And we studied this at two loop level. This becomes quite complicated because what you get, these two loop coefficients are long polynomials of order 4 and 9. At 4 is a one loop and 9 order is at two loops. And the question you need to ask is what happens with this condition on this polynomial which sets, which is integrability condition. And the answer is that at one loop order is zero, this derivative over tau is zero and the second loop order as well. So there's no deformation of the model required and integrability is preserved beyond one loop order. So explicit example with free coupling, with just three couplings, we can set two levels to zero, then integrability condition becomes relation between coefficient B and the symmetric part of this rho ij and the other two. So X, Y, Z are three combinations and that's how RG equations look like explicitly now. So we use this polynomial, these two polynomials, they simplify somewhat in terms of this X, Y, Z, and that's explicit form of RG equations. And what you see is that the RG flow is closed on this X, Y, Z. So explicitly we solve the integrability condition, but flow is consistent with that. So
for Arkady, models, 4 minutes.
5 minutes, okay.
4 minutes.
4 minutes, okay. So same story for coset models. So here, we start with usual coset sigma model, which is currents with projection to the G over H, or you can think of this as gauging the H. And if you take a product of groups and gauge diagonal subgroup, H is subgroup of each G, and I think Gleb discussed this. So we get to this construction by Arutyunov, Bassi, and Lacroix. Here the model has more couplings. So you have currents from from the coset part, G over H. Currents B are from subgroup H. And they can have independent couplings, rho ij and rij, and again levels. So the new thing is this rj, rij, which they have to do with subgroup H. So in particular for G times over H group, over each model, that's what we have. These matrices are 2 by 2. And we can choose, say, levels to be equal up to sine, as Gleb discussed. This is gauge invariance condition. And then Rij needs to take this form. It's parameterized by R and K, so two parameters. Plus rho ij appearing here. So these are three parameters just for gauge invariance, K, R, rho ij. And then integrability condition is on top of that. And that's a vanishing of two polynomials now, F1 and F2. That's how they look like in terms of raw ij, r, and k. So they can solve explicitly, for example, choosing r equal k, rho 1, 2 equals 0. So then it's enough global symmetry here. So you can argue that only r and rho ij can run. So even before we fix r equal k, which is integrability, with k not running, we can just ask what happens in this model in general. We have r and rho ij, how they run. And that's how they run. This is r, s, t, b, u again. These are RG equations for all of these parameters. And if you look closely at them, well, these are two beta functions for the, so again, these are RG equations at one loop level. At two loop level, you get some more complicated polynomials. And what you discover that integrability is preserved at one loop order. You don't need any deformation, of course. So that's consistent with usual lore. Integrability is one loop RG flow related. But at two loop level here, we find that we need deformation. And either you deform the metric or you deform this integrability conditions or these polynomials. And that deformation is actually expected because we have gauging here. So there's a close analogy with gauge with Zeminovic model and lambda model. But maybe if we stay on extended configuration space, introduce gauging gauge fields and parameterize them by new fields, RG flow may linearize, and that will be similar to what happens in lambda. So that's, again, there is a difference between gauge model and ungauged GGG model, that in gauge case, we need to some deformation or go to some bigger space. So now very quickly, I mentioned a T1Q model, and that's essentially just generalization of what Gleb discussed for T11. We observed that if the subgroup H is abelian, there is an extra possibility to keep, to have a new parameter. So we can have levels not equal to each other up to sign, but keep them different, and then introduce a new parameter, which is their ratio, the parameter Q. And then in particular for SQ2 or C1 or U1 model, you get a metric, not T11, but T1Q. So Q enters as a coefficient here and in the B field. So one of these second current has this Q coefficient. That's a ratio of these two levels. K tilde is just minus K2. Anyway, so that's a metric. Again, R should be equal to K if you want integrability. So this should be related, as Gleb discussed, similar thing for Q equal one, but this was his case. But let's keep R and K arbitrary at the moment. So just to recall, if K is equal to zero, no B field, and R is an H tilde fixed to be particular, that's a usual T11 Einstein space, which is base of Ricci flat conifold. And it's not integral, but if H is equal to K, is another special case, and H tilde is equal to K tilde. This is conformal T1Q model, which is a special case of GMM model, which again, Gleb discussed with Aninim CMH. Now, if Q equal one, or levels are equal, that's a model which Gleb discussed, but if R equal K, but levels are not equal, this is a new integral model. And one can look at what happens with RG flow, keeping R and K, R and K general. It's interesting to see what happens with RG flow. And the point is that R equal K, that's integrability subspace. It's a fixed line or fixed subspace in RG flow at one loop order and two loop order. And that's what essentially what you get. Restricting to this R equal K subspace, we have RG flow, which is consistent, preserved, and fixed point of that is a conformal GMM model. So you can say that flow, we indeed we flow in that conformal fixed point. So explanation for this RG stability explanation, kind of explanation, is that an interesting observation is that R equal K, this T1Q model is actually self-dual under T-duality in psi direction. So if you look at this model, psi is linear isometry, you can T-dualize in it. And after T-duality, you just get the same model basically up to redefinition of one angle. And in this case, T-duality has no alpha prime correction, no deformation. And one can see that from how gauge field enters. So in this case, you shouldn't really expect any deformation. So to summarize, classical integrable sigmoids emitting lux, classical lux, they are normally stable under RG flow with finite set of couplings. And if there is enough global symmetry or local symmetry, RG is actually RG stability is preserved also at higher levels. So in examples are standard coset models or these G over G models, which we discussed earlier, lambda modeling standard formulation, et cetera. But in general, the symmetry is hidden. And to preserve it, we need some finite local counter terms. And that will mean to have stability of RG on the fine on the same subspace of couplings, we need to quantum deform target space geometry. And again, this is, has to do with preservation of hidden symmetries through some body identities, et cetera. And it should be related somehow with a quantum integrability or quantum integrable S-matrix, which should be underlying structure of these models. So that applies to usual Young-Baxter deformation and lambda model. And similar examples appear in T-duality and gauge Vesemin models. And I also mentioned Poisson DDL. So I guess I stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Arkady. So a few urgent questions. Just keep in mind that we're going to have discussion session after next talk. So if you have some very important question to ask, you better keep for discussion. I have one stupid question. So talking about possible deformation, what will happen if I just apply this T-bar deformation? How does it fit into your scheme?
It doesn't at all, because that will give me non-randomizable theory. So usual two-dimensional sigma model, it is randomizable on an infinite dimensional space of couplings, where you preserve number of derivatives. You have two derivatives. So power counting is sort of randomizable. You don't have any other scales, mass scales. But they still have infinite number of couplings. It's a feature of two-dimensional theories. In four dimensions, that will be a theory with four derivatives. Mm-hmm. Where you can put some sigma model with four derivatives will be, yeah. So once you have TT bar, you're out of this comfort zone. You need to have, you will need to add more and more derivatives.
It isn't true that what I learned that in this TT bar deformation, there is fixed point of normalization when you get to some new theory.
Yes, it's an interesting question how you're going to see that. That's like asymptotic safety in gravity. Is there some finite subspace on which you stay? You can, it's an interesting question. It's different, somewhat different from this story, but that's what should happen there as well, in a particular. I think it's okay. I agree. This is an interesting question and. But it's non-trivial already at the level of, say, usual number action in string. Mm-hmm. So what will happen is you will have power divergences, essentially. So if you have, you need to choose a particular randomization scheme where you ignore, say, power divergences and then you need to put some constraints on how you define the theory. But in general, it's non-trivial.
Thank you. Valoya?
The quick question. Arkady, suppose we consider a famous example of CPN sigma model where you have classical integrability but no quantum integrability. What would you expect from your scenario of renorm group?
I think you will not see this anomaly from the RG flow. There is anomaly of integrability, but this is anomaly of some current. I think it will not be seen at that level. So it will still be randomizable.
So your method mostly works for detecting the classical integrability, yes?
Well, it's not, in a way, it's not a necessary condition, but not sufficient. So it may happen that, you have preservation by RG flow, but, and in fact, maybe I misrepresented somewhat. Yeah, you can have these models, G over G times G models, which are not integrable for particular, you can relax integrability condition. It's still renormalizable. So you can have renormalizability, but not integrability. But the other way around, it should work. So if you start with integral model with finite number of couplings, you better stay on the same subset of couplings.
Okay, thanks.
And last but very short question by Ruslan.
You know, in the talk by Arutyunov, he derived the T11 model by using the so-called Godin modules. Is it possible to relate your T1Q models in some way to derive from the Godin modules?
Very good question. We don't know answer to that. So our construction was, we kind of jumped directly to the level which was where they got from original construction from Gaden, but here we just generalized essentially their construction. It's a good question how this can be generalized and embedded into this, if it can be embedded in this Gaden. Maybe, maybe not.
I have one more general questions, but I think during discussion. Yes, of course.
Yeah, let's start the discussion. So let's thank Arkady again, and let's slowly move to the next talk.